celebration here at Greater Things. Grace Bible Church, amen. The church that God has blessed, put his hand upon. We're going to celebrate God's goodness. We're going to celebrate God's power. We're going to celebrate God's love, amen. We're going to celebrate God's peace, amen. We're going to celebrate God's glory today, amen. Let's turn up right now. Stand up right now. And let's give God a great big standing ovation. Because God is so worthy of all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor, amen. Let us bless the Lord. Let us magnify the Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
Let's make a joyful noise to the Lord God. All ye men. Hallelujah.
Everybody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
God is good.
All the time.
For those of us in the sanctuary, for those who are experiencing the worship service on the internet, I want to welcome you to the Greater Faith Grace Bible Church, where Pastor Harry Lee Grant is the pastor. The church is located in the city of Rialto, approximately on the corner of Sycamore and Randall. Sunday school starts at 9 o'clock. Prayer time starts at 10 to 10:15, and 10:15 our morning worship service. And I want to invite everybody who's experiencing the worship service on the internet to come to the church. Amen. What are we about? We are worshiping and serving the Lord. We are uplifting the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Because God is an awesome God.
Yes.
Let me tell you about a man in the Bible who believed God was an awesome God. Genesis 5:22 says, after he begat Methuselah, Enoch walked with God 300 years and had sons and daughters. And Enoch, verse 24 says, and Enoch walked with God, and it was not, for God took him. You know, I believe the Lord put this scripture in the Bible to let us know that we can walk with God.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You know, way back when folks were worshiping idols and just doing everything according to the dictates of their heart.
Well,
y'all know what I'm talking about. Folks are doing the same thing today, but Enoch said, I'm going to make God the apple of my eye.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I'm going to walk with him. One translation Bible said that Enoch had constant fellowship with God. I'm telling you, that's awesome.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
That's awesome. Constant fellowship with God. A God that he could not see, but yet he could experience the Lord. And I want everybody to know today that a man can walk with God.
Yes, sir.
A man can have constant fellowship with the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. Through Jesus, through the Word of God, and through the Holy Spirit. You know, when you walk with God, you can just tell God what's on your mind. You can ask God questions. You know, it's one thing to ask a man or a woman a question, but we ought to always go to the King of Kings. Even those who are not Christians, if you have a question about life or what your destiny is or what you should be doing, you should go straight to God yourself and talk to God.
Yes.
That's what God did with Adam in the garden. He talked with him. And you know, not only was God the apple of Enoch's eye, but Enoch was the apple of God's eye. It says, he was not, for God took him. Now this is what Hebrews 11:6 says. For before he was taken, he had this testimony that he pleased God.
Yes.
That's what I call a testimony.
Hallelujah.
He pleased God. God was pleased with him. How many of y'all want God to be pleased with your life? I know how to do it.
Glory, glory.
I'm not so much worried about if my neighbors, if I'm pleasing them, all the people at my job, but if I'm pleasing the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, the one I have to answer to one day, if I'm pleasing him, then I say I'm okay. I'm okay. That's what life is all about, pleasing God. But I want you to know today that you can walk with God. All it takes is a decision.
Yes, sir.
That's all. I said all it takes is your decision and my decision.
Hmm.
God will meet us more than halfway.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
More than halfway.
Yes, sir.
To make up our minds to walk with God.
Yes,
you know what? When we walk with God, our mission gets a whole lot easier.
Yes, sir. Yes, yes.
Y'all know what the mission is. And you know why you got to know it every week? Because you got to do it every week.
Yes, sir.
Our mission, connecting people to our Lord Jesus Christ. That's what it's all about. We worship and praise Him now, but when we leave the church, that's when the mission starts. Telling folks about Jesus, inviting people to the house of God that they may hear the word of God. Why do we got to keep saying about the mission? Because, you know, sometimes we forget. The devil wants us to forget. The devil wants us to get so busy during the week that we have no time for God, no time to do what He commands us to do. And the last one, the last words, what Jesus said, go ye into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. That's the mission. You want to know what your destiny is? To tell somebody about Jesus. You want to help get somebody ready for the next life. That's what it's all about. If we can do that, guess what? Our living will not be in vain. So y'all know what y'all got to do this week. God blesses everybody with somebody to tell about Jesus.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Somebody going to cross your pathway this week. You can tell them about Jesus. You can invite them to the house of God.
Yes, sir.
You can give them a scripture. That's what it's all about. Right now we're getting ready for baptism time. You know what that means? That means that God has saved some souls.
Yes.
God is still in the saving business. I said He's still in the saving business. This time, Pastor Brad's going to take charge.
Amen.
Woo. Today we witness that, the baptism ceremony. Baptism does not save us. It is our faith in the life of Christ, His death, His burial, His resurrection. Our faith in that, His work on the cross, is what gives us eternal life. Baptism is a seal. Baptism acknowledges that. It demonstrates that we've died to the old man and now we're rising up to the newness in life. And we who have experienced the life-changing blood of Christ in our hearts, and we have been baptized and identified with what Brother Ron is going to do this morning.
Right.
To God be the glory.
Yeah.
To God be the glory. To God be the glory. At this point, Brother Ron Marshall.
Take me to the water. To Lord a few years ago and is baptized, but now we understand a more richer significance of this day. So today he comes to be baptized and truly, fully committed to the Lord Jesus Christ. He's going to take a few moments right now to share with the church a brief short testimony. Amen.
Morning, church.
Morning. To God.
Yes.
And today by doing this, this will validate my personal commitment, my relationship with him.
Amen.
And I just continue to keep my place and keep in the position for the blessings. And today is one of those blessings. And I think I want to thank all my church family here for support and it's a blessing, it's truly a blessing, and I'm truly grateful that it, you know, I'm here to share this, you know, with you guys.
Amen. God bless you, praise God. God bless
you. It's real when God changes a person's heart from the inside.
Yes.
It's personal and it's real. And it's a blessing, amen. What's a greater thing at the Grace Bible Church? The witness of this event in the life of Brother Ron Marshall. Brother Ron, would you raise your hand? Brother Ron Marshall, do you believe with your whole heart that Jesus Christ is God's only begotten Son?
Yes, I do.
Brother Ron Marshall, Do you believe in your heart that Jesus Christ died on the cross, was buried, and rose again?
Yes, I do.
Brother Ron Marshall, have you received and believed that Jesus Christ is your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes, yes.
Hallelujah.
Brother Ron Marshall, by the confession of your faith,
in the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, and your desire to show that new life in Christ is a demonstration of the old man dying and new person rising to newness of life, I'm Pastor Harry Grant, the Greater Faith Grace Bible Church, and by the power given to me, the calling in my life of the Lord Jesus Christ, I now baptize you, Brother Ron, in the powerful name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy
Come
church family just wants to show you how much we love you. And we're going to miss you. Can I have Dee come up and say a few words to Sue?
Snacks ready, and I came to know her as a very loving, caring person, and her and Ron, when Pastor Ron was in the hospital going through his final surgery, these two came and stayed with us most of the day until Ron couldn't sit in any longer. Then they went home, but I thank you for that again, and I'm going to miss you so much.
Reverend Richards, will you come up?
Deacon Ron. First of all, Deacon Ron is like a brother that I never had. Because I have a brother, I'm the oldest. But Deacon Ron, he's a man of God. And he's always there for me. You know, whenever I need a ride or something, he'll come up and say, well, Reverend Richards, you need a ride or whatever, I don't know, just call him. You know, and sometimes I would call him, and then I thank him because see, when he can't make my appointment to take me, then his wife does, sisters. So I can't speak on Deacon Ron without mentioning sisters. Because to me, both of them are very important to me. You know, Sister Sue, she called me for my appointment when I left the guy. You know, like when I forget, she'll text me or she'll call me and she'll say, you know, you got an appointment coming up. I said, oh, I do. You know, and so, you know, I look at her as my mother. You know, although my mother passed, or my sister. You know, I think I'll say the reason I say my sister, my mother, because she's about the same age as my mother. See, so I'm gonna miss both of them, and I can't say enough. You know, but both of them are very vital. And I know they're important to the church. So we're going to miss them.
Okay, would anyone else like to come up and say a few words? Come to me.
I wasn't prepared for this, but the Lord had me in my heart. I'm a beautiful sister in Christ. I haven't been in church for a while because, of course, you know, my husband passed away. And it still hurts a little because he was the love of my life and he was a man of God. But when he got sick, I didn't have to tell Sue to come and visit me. I didn't have to come and bring food for us because she knew I was going through a lot with Raymond. When he passed away, I wanted to die because I wanted to go to heaven with my husband. But if it wasn't for Sue to come over here and comfort me, I don't know what I would have done. And I praise God that she's my angel. God sent her to me. And sometimes when you serve the Lord, He always sends the ones that really can come and help you.
That's right. That's right.
She don't complain. She didn't ask for money. I wanted to pay her for her services. And she says, no. She says, this is my ministry. And I praise God that when the day she passes away, she's going to have a big throne right next to Jesus and say, thank you, Sue, for serving me, and thank you for the ones that needed you the most. And I praise the Lord, and I'll always love her, and I'll always cherish her in my heart.
Yeah.
Secretary, sometimes you got to give me a call. And I put some announcements in there for the prayer words. And if I'm late, since Donna called me, Reverend Dingle, we need that announcement. She called me. And Deacon Garner is one of my prayer words. We're going to miss him, but he's going to be praying down there in Arizona.
Amen.
At some church.
Amen.
Pray for them that they find a good Bible teaching church. Bible teacher. We're going to miss y'all both. We're going to miss y'all.
Okay, one more.
Yes, indeed.
She
works in the kitchen, food ministry, transport, pickup, drop off, Lyft driver. And Brother Ron, I just love you to death. A couple of times I've asked him to pray for me, and I just believe that, you know, he opened the door, you know, for God to answer prayers. You know, he opened the door for me. And I truly don't miss you. And Arizona is going to be so proud to have you too in their state.
Present to them, come up now at this time. Sorry, you're gonna have to pack one more box.
Church to serve you, to help others. I pray Godspeed and your blessings over them as they go to Arizona. Watch over them, Lord God, whichever mode of transportation they travel. Be with them. Send your angels to watch over them, to keep them and guide them. And I pray, Lord, that you use them to your glory, whatever church that they will join in Arizona. Help them to pick the right church. And all the blessings that they stand in need of, we pray over their lives. In Jesus' name, we thank and praise you. Amen.
Amen.
That's why the third time he came, You went down the aisle and joined the church. I'm going to miss you, folks. I'm going to miss you, folks. I haven't been able to make it much lately to church because my body's kind of giving me a bad time. And I could watch on the streaming, but that's not near the same as coming in to have fellowship.
Amen.
And that's what I'm going to miss. God's not finished with his church or with you folks either. So just keep staying on the course. And there's going to be a time when we'll all get back together again. I love my pastors. Pastor Harry, Pastor Dingle, Pastor Michaels. It was Pastor Ring, gone. Gone home. And Pastor Ron, who's gone. I look forward to seeing them again.
Amen. God bless both of you. And again, it's Pastor Brad. I want to just say to both of you, job well done.
Yes.
Job well done. Well done. Let's thank God for your time served here. I'm going to miss you, but I know in God's infinite wisdom, he'll raise up somebody, amen. Not to replace you, amen, but to carry on with you and God.
Hallelujah.
We praise God for that, amen. We know that, we thank God that even if you go to Arizona, we know that it's not that far away. And thank God for media. We can still be in contact. And that's such a blessing, amen. And we thank God for you. Know that God's hand upon you. May God protect you. May all your prayer be answered. And God be with you. We love you so much. And we always know that when we come to Arizona, we've got a place to stop at. Amen. Amen. It's so hard to say goodbye. Goodbye. So long. So long. Glory to God, amen. To God be the glory. I like this night. This morning, we're going to pray this morning. If I know some people in the church, amen. Sometimes in our journey on life's way, sometimes we just need to hear a word from God.
Yes, yes, yes.
Sometimes we're just like the little boy Samuel. God spoke to him three times. You go and ask. Elijah. As God spoke, he said, no, go back, go to the body. He said, Lord, said, this time say, Lord, speak, for your servant hears.
Yes.
And this morning, some of you just need to say, Lord, speak, for your servant hears. So I'm going to pray this morning. You know who you are, amen. You know what you're up against. God knows everything, amen. You've been crying out, God, I just need a word.
Hallelujah.
I need a word, God. I'm in something, going through something.
Yeah.
And God, I just need a word.
Yeah.
So this morning, I'm just praying this morning for those in the audience today, those who are watching later on YouTube and live streaming, that you'd also hear a word from God. Would you bow your heads, humble your hearts, let's go to God. Holy Father, Holy Father, we still believe that you speak. You're not a quiet God. You speak, Father.
And today, Lord, we just gather because we desperately, many of us desperately crying out, God, we need, I need a word from you. A word from on high that will challenge me, that will correct me, that will comfort me, that will control me, that will convict me, Father, my heart, my soul cries out, saying, Father, I'm your child. I need a word from you. I need it, Father. All week long, Father, I've heard from family and friends. I've heard from social media. I've heard from different areas. I've heard, Lord God, from athletes. I've heard from the news. I've heard from the rich and famous. I've heard from politicians. I've heard from my neighbors. But Lord, that did not help my situation. That did not comfort me. That did not guide me. That did not help me. So this morning, Father, from the depths of our souls, we cry out saying, Father, speak. For your servant hears. And we want a word from you, Father. And Father, as you give us a word, we purpose in our hearts that we'll obey your word, receive your word, and walk in your word. And Father, I know that you know what each one of us needs. That word from on high, because you still speak today, Father. That word may come through a song. That word, it may come through a prayer. That word, it may come, Lord God, through prayer. It may come through the Holy Spirit, Lord God. It may come just through your word, Lord God. But God, we want to hear from you. Because we know, Father, if we hear from you, Lord God, we know it is a living word that abides forever. So, Father, today, all of us who are crying out from the depths of our soul,
yes, Lord,
because you know us individually, give us a word, Father, that would leave this place we can truly say, I've received a word from on high. We pray this in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Because your word abides forever. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Give God some praise. Now say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
I believe.
I'm going to receive
a word from God today.
Word from God.
Give God some more praise. Give God some more praise. Glory.
Amen. Amen. After our music minister, Sister Tanya, leads us, we're going to have children's church shortly. And Pastor Marvin Rich is going to be preaching the children's sermon before you.
Amen.
Can
I come up real quick? Amen.
Yeah.
We're gonna do. I'm so glad. Amen. I'm
after
so
that,
satisfied.
And that song, Pastor Brad's gonna preach the word of God.
All right. All right. All right. All right.
there too and out here. So we'll do too. Thank you.
Thank you. Church. We're located at 249 East Randall Avenue in the city of Rialto. And welcome to come and join us as the Lord leads you to celebrate God's goodness and grace and mercy. May God bless you.
God bless you also.
Praise God. great, great, great day to come to magnify, to exalt, to celebrate the goodness of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank God for all of our friends here today, our ushers, our multimedia team, our music teams. Sweetheart, God bless you. The songs this morning, the choir, amen. For the dingle, we thank God for each one and the part that you play here, for your prayers and your much, much support, amen. Amen. And we give a shout out and thank you for the service that was rendered to this church. We need it, Ron and Sue Garner. And then we say much obliged, God be the glory. I've learned that in life is always full of doors, opening and closing,
yes, yes.
Exiting and entering, amen.
Yes.
And my dad always says, son, when you see people, always try to leave them better off than you found them. Never make any worse than them, amen.
Amen.
And so I say to Brother Ron and Sue Garnet, amen, you made Greater Faith Grace Bible Church better off. Thank God so much. Amen. Amen. Well, it's a little later than normal to start preaching, about 4:12 now, so prayerfully we shall still make our exit around between 12:15 and 12:30. Amen. So you guys shout with me and raise your hands once in a while and say a few amens and hallelujahs. Now that I'm heading the right direction, and God will bless us, and we'll hear a word from God.
Amen.
Let's pray. Holy Father, we thank you for our position, our privilege of being in Christ Jesus. We pray, God, for anyone today who is not in Christ Jesus, or who has walked a little way from the faith, that they come back to the faith and experience your newness. We pray, God, that you give us a word on high. So, Father, open our mouths that we can praise you. Open our eyes to see your glory. Open our ears, oh God, to hear your voice. Open our minds to be transformed by your word.
Yeah.
Open our hearts, oh God, to receive your fullness. We cry to you, God, say, help us and strengthen us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Great y'all guys, your notepads and hustle out and take a few notes here and there. Amen. And we turn now back to the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 13. And we're going to close out this book, this chapter rather, not the book of this chapter again, with part 4. It's all about love.
Yes. Amen.
It's all about love. Amen. And a couple weeks ago, we gave an assignment. I pray that somebody had an opportunity to do some random acts of kindness.
Yes.
Amen. Take a card or two from back there, and I gave you a list of 100 things you can do to show kindness. And just before you pass it, they say, Lord God, I want you to use me to show someone the love of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So I want to represent him and represent him well for his glory. Amen.
Amen.
So that being said, we're going to now dig into chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians. Amen. And for just to kind of give us a brief review of where we're at here, kind of bring us up to date, things in context. In chapter 13 here, the Apostle Paul wanted the Corinthian church to lay hold of, to grasp, a more excellent way for the community of believers to follow Jesus Christ. In chapter 12, they were so hung up and tied up on spiritual gifts, amen. So we find in chapter 12 and in verse 31, he says, but earnestly desire greater gifts. And I show you still a more excellent way. And so what happened was, again in chapter 12, they're hung up on these spiritual gifts. And because they put so much emphasis on spiritual gifts, it led to this church having lots of pride. They were jealous of each other's gifts. A certain gift they had, they were proud of it. This gift exhibited pride and jealousy. There was envy over the gifts that God had given them. And there was much confusion about those gifts. They were saying, well, I got this gift, so I'm all that. And you have this gift, and you have nothing. And I want your gift, and I want this gift. And there was just a lot of confusion and jealousy. And so Paul wanted to show them a more excellent way. Amen. And so Paul moves on to chapter 13. And Paul takes the most prideful and most envious gifts, tongues, prophecy, knowledge, faith, and giving, and he drops a bomb on them and says, you have all these gifts, but if you're not saturated with unconditional, genuine love, you have nothing, you do nothing, and you are nothing. That was a bomb on them. They think I can speak in tongues, I got prophecy, and I do giving and all this stuff like that, and I'm all that, I'm the head honcho and stuff like this. And Paul said, all that, you ain't got unconditional, genuine love, you have nothing, you are nothing, and you do nothing. Talk about dropping a bomb on them. Phew. Oh my goodness. And so Paul then, after dropping that bomb on them, and see, sometimes we get so full of pride, envy, God, some of you gotta drop a bomb on them. Say, you ain't all that. Amen. You are what you are by the grace of God. You think you're all that. No, no, no. And so Paul then asked them to take the 15 question love test. Paul, I'm going to give you this morning, a snap quiz. I'm going to give you a quiz this morning, Paul says. Yeah. See, sometimes we just need for God to give us a quiz sometimes, amen. Ask us some questions and really see how we line up with, amen. And so Paul said, I'm going to give you guys, amen, a 15 question pop quiz. Amen. And he said the first one, because you got all these gifts, see if you really love, the first one is, are you patient with one another? That's the first question. And this question is not multiple choice, it's true or false. Amen. It's not an essay, it's not multiple choice. Well, I'm patient this time with that. No. It's true or false? He said, are you patient with one another? True or false? Second question, are you kind to one another? True or false? Third question, are you jealous to one another? True or false? Pop quiz. He said, do you brag on yourself? True or false? Are you arrogant? True or false? You find these questions, verses 4 through 7, amen. The next question, do you act unbecomingly? True or false? Are you selfish out of what you can get? True or false? Are you irritable? Bipolar. Y'all bipolar, forgive me. Amen. True or false? Are you irritable?
Number nine question. Do you look to the end with people who have wronged you? True or false? Number 10. Do you rejoice in ungodliness? True or false? Well, I did a little pop quiz, huh? And it still works today. Amen. Then he says, do you rejoice in the truth? True or false? Number 12. Do you bear all things? True or false? Number 13, do you believe all things? Number 14, do you hope all things? And number 15, do you endure all things? 15 questions, true or false? Amen. And so they look at these questions right as Paul presents to them. And then say, you know what, sometimes we miss them, amen. Well, he said, you know, I got four of them right. You know, I only missed two of them, you know, one of them. But the Bible says, amen, if you break one law, you've broken all of them, amen. So if you didn't get 100%, amen, you broke them all. Amen. God does not break on a curve, amen. He wants 100%, amen. Because then he goes on to say in verse 8, if you do all these things, amen, says, love never fails. In other words, Paul is saying, love never fails to do any of those four mentioned things. Love always do those things. Those 15 questions, love will always do or not do those things, amen.
Yes, yes.
Because love never fails, amen.
Amen.
He goes on to say, amen, love never, never fails. He says, but there are a gift of prophecy. They will be done away. There are tongues, they will cease. And if there is knowledge, it will be done away. Amen. Now, Paul takes that prophecy and knowledge will be abolished. Tongues will cease. Amen. Now, as you read your Bible, sometimes it's good to read different translations when you're doing a Bible study. And then also, when you're doing a Bible study, amen, always learn to ask the four questions. Who, what, when, why, and how. Always, when you're reading a text, ask those questions of the text. Who, when, where, why, and how.
Yes.
And as you read this, it says, in the New American Standard, it says, prophecy will be done away. If there are tongues, they will cease. And if there is knowledge, it will be done away. For we know in part and prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will be done away. So ask myself a question. Why is something done away, abolished, and why is something ceased? Why is prophecy and knowledge done away, and why is tongues ceased? Why didn't just say prophecy, tongues, and knowledge will be done away, or they'll all be just abolished? Why does Paul make the distinction right there as tongues ceasing and knowledge and prophecy being done away, abolished? Okay. Ask the question of the text.
Yes.
Why? Well, being asked the question, simply, done away means abolished. When you abolish something, guess what? It's gone. It never comes back, amen. It can't happen again. It can't happen. It's abolished, amen. If a law is abolished, it can't come back, right? It's done away with, amen. So it's saying there'll come a time when prophecy and knowledge will be abolished, amen. But then it says tongues will cease. And cease means it can stop for a period of time and then restart. You hear sometimes have a war where they have a ceasefire?
Yeah.
They're saying both sides stop fighting.
Yep.
Let's cease fire. But if something happens, we're going to stop fighting again.
Right.
Amen? So he says, times will come a time that will cease, amen. But there may come a time, amen, when it may come back. And when that time is, we'll discuss that. We'll discuss that, amen. But I think what's saying, right, it'll cease, amen. It's not going to be abolished, it's going to cease for a period of time. So always, when you see things like that, and you read the Bible, and you see lists of stuff, ask who, what, when, why, where, and how. Ask questions of the text, amen. So that kind of clears that up right there, amen. And so go on to say, love never fails. Other things are going to fail. Prophecies are going to fail. Now, all those things will fail, but love never fails. In other words, when everything else has passed away, when all things feel so high and esteem about, one day it's going to pass away. But love never, never fails. I mean, you're going to lose a few battles here and there, but ultimately, love will win out.
Glory.
Say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Love never fails.
Never fails.
That's why it's all about love. It's all about love, amen. Done away. He says, for we know in part, we prophesy in part, but when perfect has come, the partial done away. Done away with it. Amen. And see, love is the greatest thing. Love is supreme. It's the most magnificent thing, amen. And we need to always remind ourselves that we need to be loving and kind. And I want to share with you this morning. I want to read this to you. On my tablet, I always have a lot of Bible verses and devotion things. I try to have these books of devotion. I hope you have a tablet or a smartphone. You have the Bible on there.
Yes.
Amen. You have some good devotion material on there. Things you can always read. So you're sitting around waiting, amen. You're not sitting there playing games. Amen. You're sitting and read something that's going to bless you, amen. And I found this morning, I think this is so in time, in tune with what we're saying about love today, amen. And it's called latest devotion that I download on my phone. And it's called Ambassadors of Love. So bear with me as I read this to you here, amen. It says, through his children, God is trying to show the world what he is like. Jesus said, as my Father has sent me, I also send you. Jesus came to love the world, and he calls us to do likewise in every facet of life. The only way that others will find his joy and peace and love and happiness in heaven is through us. No matter where we're from, if we have Jesus, we are now his ambassadors and represent the King of Kings, the one who runs the universe. What was Jesus' last message to disciples at the Last Supper? Just before he was arrested, taken to jail, beaten, and killed, he said, by this all will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. He talked about love. That love was the most important thing. Goes on to say here. Those first Christians turned the world upside down with the love of God. The way they lived convinced others that their faith was real. Even the Roman persecutors marveled. He said, look how these Christians love one another. Who is this Christ? They asked the Christians. And how does he make you so happy? Even though you have nothing, you've got everything. How can I find this happiness too? And within 200 years, one out of five people in the Western world were professing Christians. Goes on to say,
glory.
Nearly 2,000 years later, the heart of man is still the same. So many people are searching for love, but seldom ever finding it. People everywhere are looking around for some little ray of hope, some salvation, some bright spot somewhere, a little love, a little mercy, someplace where they can find some relief. We who have found God and his love have what others have been searching for all their lives and need desperately. And we can show them that love exists, then they can believe that God exists because God is love. Go on and say, closing says here, every little thing, even the little things you do can mean a lot. The light of your smile, the kindness on your face, the influence of your life can shed light on many and have an amazing effect on some people you think might be least likely to impress. When they feel your love and you tell them it's God's love, they think, maybe somebody up there really does love me. It can change their whole outlook on life and give them a new start. May we always be known by our love. And use scripture here, John 13:35. By this, all men should know you are my disciples if you have loved one for another. Then Romans 13:10 says, love worketh no ill, therefore love is fulfilling the law. Hebrews 13:1 says, let brotherly love and kingdom.
Hallelujah.
How timely that is, amen.
Amen.
Showing love. We've got all this stuff. We got all kinds of church work and do this, all this stuff. But if it's not rooted and grounded in love, genuine love, it means nothing. Love is the greatest thing. And it's nothing greater than love.
Amen.
True gift is love. God said, I am love. Amen. We have come to know the love of God. Agape love. That's love that says, I love you just because you are you. With no strings attached. You are you. You have great value, great worth. Therefore, I love you just as you are. Amen. And when people come into a church setting, amen, they must know that they are welcome, they are loved, they are valued, and they have great worth and great dignity.
Amen.
People come to the church and say, you know, you are valuable, and you have, and you, I give you respect and dignity, amen. And we need to show that, because the world does not give it. And we need to show that it. People are looking for love. See, love is a true gift from God, amen. A person only knows true love only as they come to know the love of God.
Yeah.
The true love of God, amen. Apart from God, people love those who love them. It's, I love you if I can get something from you. I love you because, amen. As long as you treat me right, I love you. No, no. Love, I love you just because you are you. That's why I love you, amen. Just because you are you. Man. Is helping y'all so far?
Yes.
Is blessing y'all so far, amen?
Because
the world is a hurting place.
Yes.
And we need to let them know it's all about love. Then he goes on to say, look what he says, when I was a child, I used to speak like a child, think like a child, reason like a child. When I became a man, I did what a child was thinking. Paul said, you know, he's an analogy here, analogy. When you was a child, you thought a certain way, but now he said, I'm mature now, okay? All the other stuff is behind me now. I'm going to walk in Christ. I'm a new person right now. Paul said, you know, I act like a child, think like a child. He says, those things right there are child's amen. So now, get the big picture, amen. So when we come adults, we get the big picture right now, amen. So get the big picture here. Thank you for trying to do those things here. And then he says, here's the key word, it says, for now we see through a mirror dimly, but then face to face, now I know in part, when I'm fully, but then I will know fully just I've also been known. Notice what Paul says, this is the key word, it says, we see through a, some Bible say a mirror, and some Bible say a glass darkly. It says, amen. We see in a mirror dimly. You think, well, a mirror dimly, you think when you go to your house, you look at a mirror, mirror is bright, you see everything, right? You look in your big full mirror, and you look and it's very clear, right? But he said here, we see through a mirror dimly, darkly. What Paul was saying is that in Corinth, where they did, they had a lot of really highly polished brass. And it showed a reflection of the face, but not that clear. That's why I said, in the great look at a mirror, it was highly polished bronze. They could see a reflection of their face, but it was not that clear. That's why Paul said, they see through a mirror dimly. See, and we right now, we don't see the full picture, amen, what God's going to do. But there'll come a time, praise God, we'll see the full glory, the full picture. We'll be known, amen. Known as he is known, amen. Love. It's all about love. It's all about love. See, and then Paul goes on to say here, But now by the faith, hope, love, abide these three, but the greatest of these is love. Is love. The greatest of these is love. And see, there's a these three. Faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these is love. When you have true agape love, it never gets diminished. You may have a little faith, amen. Sometimes your faith is a little like that because Jesus said, oh, you little faith. And sometimes you have hope, you have a faith, amen. But if you have a genuine agape love, it never stops, amen. You know, think about this, right? You hear stories of people, sometimes they may be in a really, about to die sometimes, but actually they'll text them and say, you know, I love you. They don't say, I thank you, I hope you. They text, I love you. But the last phone call, I love you. They never say, you know, and they die and say, you know, I thank you, I hope you. No, no, it's I love you. But all said and done, amen. It's still, I love you. When people are on their dying bed, around your loved one, you say, you laugh with that loved one, honey, I love you. I love you. That's the greatest gift, amen, is love. What Paul says, those goodbyes, but the greatest is love, amen. You all want to have a part of your life. What was a part of it? I love you. When I love one of you, I always say, I love you. Let that be your last word, I love you. You never know. When you might see that person again, I love you. That's the greatest gift, amen. See, we know it's good because the world today is looking for love. And many times they're looking for it all the wrong places. We find it in poetry, looking for love. We find it in songs, secular songs, that are looking for love. Love is the greatest. See, it's all about love. Yes. Let me just walk you through some songs from the secular world. I've been trying to find and identify what love is. Back in the 60s, Sherelle sang a song, Will You Love Me Tomorrow? Jesus says, I love you yesterday, today, and forever. Whitney Houston sang the song, I'll always love you. God said, I love you everlasting love, whether you love me back or not. The emotions sang the song, you got the best of my love. God said, you got the best of my love in Jesus. Amen. Stevie Wonder sang the song, I just called to say I love you. God said, I sent my son to show you that I love you. Boys to Men sang a song, I'll make you love me. God said, I'll let you choose to love me. The Bee Gees sang a song, How Deep Is Your Love? God said, it's so deep you can't get under it. It's so high you can't get over it. It's so wide you can't get around it. It's so long you can't get past it. Ray Charles, played Percy Sledge, sang the song, When a Man Loves a Woman. God said, when a man loves God. A better than God loves a man. Ray Charles sang the song, I Can't Stop Loving You. God said, I've never thought about not loving you.
Yes,
hallelujah. Foreigner sang the song, I want to know what love is. God said, I am love. Yes. Al Green sang the song, Let's Stay Together. God said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. It's all about love, people. It's all about love, baby. The world is looking for love, but finding all the wrong places. It's all about love, amen. That bless you, amen.
Amen.
God said, it's all about love. I want to close, amen, with these last
few words here. There was a writer, a philosopher from Britain named Alan DeBolton. And he writes various books on topics and themes and things like that. And one of the things he wrote was about love. He said, the story goes like this. I passed an unfortunate woman in the street one day. My girlfriend asked me, they passed this woman who was very deformed, not looking that good. His girlfriend asked, said, would you love me if I had an enormous birthmark on my face like she does? The yearning is that the answer be yes. An answer that will replace love above the mundane surface of the body, or more particular, its cruel, unchangeable ones. I will love you not just for your wit and talent of beauty, but simply because you are you, no strings attached. I love you for the one you are deep in your soul, not for the color of your eyes, or the length of your legs, or the size of your checkbook. The longing that the lover admires is stripped of our external assets, appreciation, essence of our being without accomplishment. Even if we are beautiful and rich, then we do not wish to be loved on account of these things, for they may fail us, and with them love. The desire is that I be loved even if I lose everything, leaving me nothing but me. This mysterious me taken to be the self at its weakest, most vulnerable point. Do you love me enough that I may be weak with you? Everyone loves strength, but do you love me for my weakness? Jesus says, yes, I love you just because you are here. And we have that love of God flowing in our hearts, amen. We can all say, yes, I love you just because you are you. That's how much I love you. Just because you are you. And so I close the day, my family and friends here. It's all about love. And I think we need to learn to love like Jesus so we can reach our world. So we can have the right kind of atmosphere in our life and our church. So we can love like Jesus Christ, folks coming in and know that we're in a house of love.
Amen.
A house of peace. A house of joy. Amen. And we cannot love like unless a church loves Jesus. That means you must be saved, born again, let God's love be inside of us.
Amen.
With Him inside, we can love like Jesus. This morning, the altar of God is open to anyone that says, you know, today I want to connect or reconnect with that kind of love. I've been looking for love in all the wrong places, amen. The answer what ails us is love. The answer is God who is love. And the more this day, somebody needs to say, today, God, I want to allow this holy God, this loving Father, I want His love to fill my heart and give my life the necessary meaning. I want this love, amen. This eternal love, amen. I want to allow the God of heaven, the Holy Father, I want His love just to erupt in my life and let me see all the beautiful possibilities that I can have in Christ Jesus. Love never ends. He's given us the best of His love. He sent Jesus Christ. He didn't call us to say He loved us. He sent His Son to show us that He loves us. I love you with an everlasting love. And no matter what you're going through, the hills can be high. The wind in your face. The road can be rough. And the going is tough. And the hills are so hard to climb. It's like you're going up on not the rough side of the mountain, but the slippery side. See, on the rough side, you got a notch to hold on to once in a while.
you can grab a little toehold, you kind of dig in, hold on. But on the slick side, you ain't got nothing.
Hallelujah.
All right,
Amen.
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 But know one thing,
God's love never fails. Whether you're on the rough side of the mountain, you got a little toehold once in a while holding on, or you're on the slick side, you slide down. God's love never fails.
Amen.
Have you ever begun to think or feel that God does not love you? Just look like a cowboy. Right then and there, God proved his love for you and me. With his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, hung on the cross. There is no greater love than that. That's love, amen. Well, what you're going through, what you're up against, you can rest assured God's love will never fail you. Never fail you.
Amen.
That which you hold on to.
Amen.
But having must come as his child, say, God, I give my life to you. So if you're here today, you come to a close, your wife come to play the song, if the Holy Spirit right now has spoken to you, and you got a word from God, and you know that you're hungry and you're thirsty and you want to be loved deeply and sincerely, and nothing so far has filled that empty void life, but God's love can do it today. So I want you to just submit us to Wednesday. God, I want your way. I want your love. You're here today, and you want that full of God's love. We're going to stand right there, everybody. If you can, please stand right now. And as you stand, just imagine yourself right now standing before the King of Kings, the ruler of the universe. And he said, you know, I want to give you the best of my love, and you've not received that. What is your excuse? Why not today? Why not this morning? Why not this hour? To say, Lord, I've strayed, I've wandered, I've never just totally received your love. And sometimes we don't always like to be loved. Say like foreigner say, I want to know what love is. God, I love. Would you come today to reunite, connect, be born again, and baptized like Brother Ron did earlier today? That's in your heart. Won't you just come out the aisle right now and let this church lovingly celebrate with you that you're receiving God's love that never, never fails. You're here today. Just come out the aisle. Come down front. We're going to lovingly receive you today. Would you come? We're going to reconnect, reunite. Word of prayer. Whatever it may be today, walk out the aisle. You know, I've wandered away from God. I've been faithfully serving God. The day I come is to rededicate, reconnect, restart my wife and God. If you're here today, then you come out the aisle. Today is your day. Today is your day. Say, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Will you come today? Right here, right now. And I wandered away. Loves you. This church loves you.
Father, for this beautiful day you blessed us with. Thank you most for your beautiful love that never leaves us nor forsakes us. Always here for us. And Father, thank you each one today who has received, embraced, and walked in that love. And I pray, God, Holy Father, all the days of our lives, we can walk in this love and let your love flow from heaven on high upon us and through us, that we can share unfailing love to this dying, hurting, lonely world. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 Am